from what Christy had mailed to them. They said, thank you very much for the stamps you sent to the stamp ministry. The income from their sale goes to support preparation, publication, and distribution of a Spanish language curriculum for Sunday schools. More than 50 lesson series have been published and are being used in churches of 40 different denominations in Spanish-speaking countries in Latin America, Spain, and even in the USA. Now, as of 2 years ago, the Alliance Stamp Ministry, with God's help, reached $1 million from what normally you would throw away. And that's using to spread the kingdom and the gospel of Jesus. Now, this year, as of May of this year, they've raised $10,000. So I just want you to know that there is value in these, and you spend time at home just cutting the stamps. I often do it when I watch TV, just to make what looks like dead time valuable time for the Lord. So grab some stamps on your way out.
And this is a great thing for kids to get involved in too. They can help you cut stamps. And there are some rules about cutting stamps.
I was just gonna say, just, they can't be cut very close to the stamp, a quarter inch. Just look at this outside, a quarter inch around the stamps. If the stamps are torn or damaged, save them also, because apparently there are crafty people who know how to use them for profit. So don't throw away the damaged stamps, but just save some paper. If you cut all the paper off, you cut our profit, because it's sold by weight. So
thank you, Susan. And isn't it awesome that this is one of the many ways that we as a local Alliance church get to work with other non-Alliance churches, all for the sake of the gospel? It's a great thing. All right, I just want to draw your attention to the table on the in the lobby, just to your left as you go out. On that table are some voter guides. These voter guides give a list of those who are being considered for election, along with the issues that are there, and check off where these people stand on the key issues of our time. So they're free, just pick one up, take one home. Be a great prayer resource as you're seeking the Lord's guidance in how you vote. And then just a reminder, we have our fifth Sunday social, the last Sunday of this month, in our fellowship hall. Please plan on bringing a main dish or a side dish or a dessert, and we're going to have a great time together there. Dan, would you come on up? He's got an announcement regarding trail life.
Good morning. I'm excited to announce that August 27th at 8 p.m. we're going to be starting back, at 7 p.m. we're going to be starting back with our Trail Life program. Now feel free to look at it, just Google that. As far as Trail Life USA, it's a fantastic program. It's nationwide in scope. We just happen to have one of the troops here. Our troop is 1045 after Mark 1045. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. That's where we're trying to keep the heart of the boys. It's definitely where the heart of the men are, who's involved in the organization, as well as the ladies that support us as well. We do have female members of Trail Life that serve and assist us. We do have a core group of boys and men. But I'm making the announcement, in case you know of young people, it's basically from kindergarten through the senior year of high school. And so we're looking for, of course, boys to participate, but we're also looking for any adults that are interested in helping out with that. You don't necessarily have to make every Thursday night meeting, but if you can go on us. Canoe trips, camp outs with us, hikes, whatever it is you're interested in, or if you have a hobby you like to come and share with the boys, there's all kinds of skills they need to learn. So if you're able to come out, just come out on, August 27th. We're meeting from 7 to 8:30, or like in Trail Life, we just like to use a military time, 1900 to 2030, but we encourage you to come out. It's a great patriotic, God-centered organization.
All right, so first I'm going to piggyback on Dan. AHG will officially be starting back on the 27th as well. Actually, I'm not sure if it's 6:30 or 7. I'll have to let you know, and there will be more details coming out about that. We're going to have a really fun celebration night because our girls were not able to have their crossover ceremony in person. So we're excited about that. The other announcement is a little more personal. First of all, I want to tell you guys that I love you. And it has been an honor and a privilege to serve as the director of music here for 12 and a half years. And our family's been involved in ministry of the church for 15 years, 15 and a half. As of August 30th, I will be stepping down from my position and God is calling me elsewhere. If you have any questions, feel free to ask me personally. I don't mind talking about it, but this isn't the place for it, so thank you.
All right, thank you, and we just need to express our love to Jackie for all of this ministry she's provided and done so excellently. Let's give her a round of applause. Arthur's going to lead us in a call to worship. We're glad to have you back, Arthur. He and Linda have had a tough time health-wise, but they're well recovered now. I'm glad to have you back. I'm alive!
Yes. Yeah, actually, thank God for that. But I did go through a bout last week. Called the pastor up. Well, Linda did. And I could barely breathe then. I'm doing a lot better now, and thank God for that. They are not contagious, in case you are wondering. But let's go ahead and I'd like to open in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 20. It says, "Therefore, we are ambassadors of Christ, as though God were entreating through us. We beg you, on behalf of Christ, to be reconciled to God. He made him who knew no sin to become sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." What does it mean to be reconciled to? To be reconciled means to be brought back together. Christ did that whenever he went to the cross and he died for our sins. He bridged that gap. And the thing that he brought to us was peace. And this peace that we have now, that we can have with God, that in the world today, there's a lot of trouble. We know that. But then again, we were never promised that we would not have troubles. But he left us with his peace, which passes all understanding. And I thank God that we can have his peace, even during these times, whenever people are struggling, not only with their finances, but with their health and with loved ones who are in hospitals, people, and those that we care about. But just remember that God is in control of all things. We may not see it, but he is in control. And we don't understand why some things happen the way they do, but they do. And we still know that God's in control. If he says what he says in his word, he means. So I thank God for his health and healing. And I'm still looking forward to continue serving the Lord as long as he'll give me breath to breathe. And so let's go ahead and open a prayer at this time. Heavenly Father God, I do thank you, Lord, that you did send your Son to die on the cross to bridge that gap, God, that we so desperately needed as being separated from you. I thank you, God, that you do grant us peace, God, in our hearts and our souls, God, for those that do believe you. I just pray, God, if there's anyone out there that does not know you, that they would turn to you today, God, to receive you as Lord and Savior, that they too may know the same peace, God, that I have in my heart. And I thank you very much for this day, God, and just be with us, God, be with every aspect of this service, Lord, in the music and in the preaching of the word, God, and just be with the pastors and empower him, God, with your Holy Spirit, God, to deliver the message, God, that we need for this day. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
I could just give one quick reminder before we go back into music, please. If you have a cell phone or electronic device that can connect to the internet and Wi-Fi, please put it on airplane mode or turn it off. This greatly assists us in having a smooth live stream connection. Thank you so much.
From the rain. The Lord is my salvation.
Continue to worship the Lord at this time. Let's do so with his tithes, with our love offerings. As we've been doing the past several weeks, we are going to encourage you who are here live to come down the center aisle, place your offerings in the plate, and return to your seats by the side aisles. And those of you who would like to support this ministry online, those of our church family who can't worship here in person, we want to encourage you to do so. All you need to do, go online to give.cornerstone.cc/FBCMA. So that's give.cornerstone.cc/FBCMA. And we so appreciate your willingness to give and help in that respect. Those of you who want to drop your offering by during the week, you can do that as well. You can bring it to the church office Monday through Thursday, 8 to 2. As the worship team comes, would you come and place your offerings in the plate? Thank you.
Please stand with us. This is a time of rejoicing. Let's join our voices together as we give our offerings to the Lord.
Thank you.
seats. And let's, the Lord deserves all that praise, including the praise of our hands. That's just awesome. As we go into prayer this morning, just for those of you who may not have heard, our sister Judy went into the hospital this morning. Actually, it's kind of an urgent care clinic with severe abdominal pain, so you want to keep her in your prayers. And we have others right here in our church family who stand in the need of prayer for healing and many other things. God is able. God is good. Amen? Let's go before Him. Lord, we just thank You for the breath that You give us to sing Your praises. It's a wonderful thing to gather together as the family of God and to sing and to rejoice about all the goodness of God, of Your great majesty and Your power, and how You are worthy of our praise. And Lord, I am so grateful as a child of God to be able, just to be able, to sing Your praises. And it's just so easy to think back on when that was the furthest thing from my heart and my mind. But You rescued me out of darkness and You brought me into Your marvelous light, and I give You praise and thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Father, we do pray for our sister Judy, and we ask God that You would bring her rapidly back to health, and we pray for her husband Joe and for all of the concerned family members. We pray, Lord, for our brother Randy and the torn tendon in his shoulder, that You bring healing there. We pray, Lord, for Julie's family. She just lost her grandpa. And Lord, we thank You that she and her family could be here today worshiping with us. We bring them to You. We bring them before the throne of grace and just ask Your mercy and Your love and Your compassion to be poured out upon that family. We pray, Lord, for our missionaries, especially for those who have desired and have been scheduled to go back to their fields of service, but because of the pandemic have been unable to do so. We pray, Lord, that in Your perfect timing, You would release all of the barriers and just pull them back, that You would grant visas and passports and all that's necessary for our missionaries to get back among the people that You've called them to serve, back bringing the gospel to those who need it most. We pray, Lord, for broader church family. We think of those, Lord, who would love to be here in worship face-to-face, but cannot at this time. And Lord, we just pray that they would know that there is no distance, there's no separation between us and them other than what can be seen in terms of the physical, but that, Lord, You are present with them just as You're present here, and You unite us in Christ, and we are bound together. Christ, and I pray that they might know the sweetness of Your presence among them as they worship in their homes or wherever they are at. We think of those, Lord, especially in our church family, who are away visiting family or away doing other things, and I pray, Lord, Your protection upon them, but also, Lord, that they might just feel the kinship that comes from being part of the family of God and this local fellowship. Lord, we pray that You would bring peace to our nation. We pray that You would restore order to our nation. We pray that You would bring sanity to our nation. We pray, Lord, that there would be righteousness restored in our nation. We pray, God, that there would be a spirit of love and of peace poured out upon our nation. Lord, we know that there are so many things, and we confess them easily, so many things that deserve Your wrath and deserve Your judgment. We admit that. And that's true for us personally. It's true for the nation. It's true for the world. But we also know that You are, as we heard today, You are a God who brings reconciliation in Jesus Christ, that You restore what was broken, that You bring back together that which was separated. And we pray, Lord, that You would bring this nation to its knees before You, that there would be a revival that would sweep across this land, and that there would be people tomorrow who today never would have said the name of Jesus out loud except perhaps as a cuss word. But that tomorrow, perhaps even beginning this afternoon or tonight, that Your Spirit would do a work in human lives, and that it would accelerate exponentially and sweep across this land. And that men and women and children would fall in love with Jesus and fall face down before the cross, acknowledging their sins and receiving you as Savior and Lord, and standing back up again in new life, new creatures in Christ, full of hope for a future that rests in you. Lord, I pray that you would put upon us who have come into your church family, you would put upon us a renewed desire, a renewed passion to share your love wherever we go, to share the good news of Jesus wherever we go, to not hold back because the days are short. And we pray, Lord, that you would open our eyes this morning as we look into your word, that you would make us receptive to your truth that you have for us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we have reached the last chapter of the book of Esther. Three big verses. You probably think that means a short message, right? You clearly don't know me. Esther chapter 10. If there's been a frustration for me at all in preaching through the book of Esther, as is often the case in preaching through the large narrative books of the Bible, I would love to spend the time just really verse by verse. But we'd probably be here 20 years from now, still going through the book of Esther. So I hope this has been enriching for you, and I hope as we wind it up this morning in Esther chapter 10, it will be equally as enriching for you. And I guess I hope above all that it will inspire you to read the word and study it for yourself. This is God's precious word, and it's never enough just to hear it secondhand. With that, Esther chapter 10, verse 1, King Xerxes imposed tribute throughout the empire to its distant shores. And all his acts of power and might, together with a full account of the greatness of Mordecai, whom the king had promoted, are they not written in the book of the annals of the kings of Media and Persia? Mordecai the Jew was second in rank to King Xerxes, preeminent among the Jews, and held in high esteem by many fellow Jews because he worked for the good of the people and spoke up for the welfare of all the Jews. You know, Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount that suffering for Jesus eventually results in a great reward, and that's the theme of this message in this last chapter, your great reward. It says in Matthew 5, verse 12, Jesus says, "Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Rejoice and be glad. Esther and Mordecai saw that truth played out in their lives on an earthly plane, and that does not always happen. We don't always get to see that great reward in this life. They were rewarded for their steadfast faith in God. They and the entire Jewish population in Persia, leaving us an earthly model of our great reward in heaven. And I, for one, I am dying to see what that reward is going to be like. I hope you are too. I got some ideas, but man, I can't wait. The closing chapter of Esther gives us a sneak peek. When we realize that Esther and Mordecai's reward is a foreshadowing of our great reward in heaven. And as you might expect by now, as we've gone through this book, there are some unexpected twists in the way God dishes out rewards. Consider verse 1. Indebted to the king, King Xerxes imposed tribute throughout the empire to its distant shores. Now, imposing tribute means he established a system of taxation, which also included drafting laborers for government projects and the military. This was customary throughout the ancient world, In Egypt, for example, you see this in Exodus 1, verse 11. So they put slave masters over them to oppress them with forced labor, and they built Pithom and Ramses as store cities for Pharaoh. And under the rule of the kings in the Bible, Israel is no different. 1 Kings 5, verse 13, King Solomon, the wisest man of all time, King Solomon conscripted laborers from all Israel, 30,000 men. Things are not so very different today. So how in heaven's name does required taxes and conscripted labor have any parallel to our great reward in heaven? Well, the answer is that our reward is only possible because we are forever indebted to the King of Kings. Think about it. Taxation is a form of government control. In a democracy or democratic republic, taxation ideally is self-imposed. In other words, the people give their representative government permission to tax them in exchange for government services and protection. In a kingdom, the citizens have no say in how they are taxed, how much they are taxed. Taxation is imposed upon them by the government as the government sees fit. This difference in philosophy over taxation, of course, was a major factor in the decision of the American colonies to break away from British rule. The colonists who rebelled felt it unfair to be under taxation without representation. We know the line. Think about this, though. The British Crown, on the other hand, they didn't see the problem. The British Empire was a kingdom, not a democratic republic. They never made any pretense that the colonies should have a say in how they were taxed. And maybe, just maybe, that would have been okay if the kings of this world always had the best interests of their subjects at heart. But that's not how things work in the real world. Not in kingdoms, not in empires, and not in democratic republics either. Worldly governments become self-serving, and taxation becomes a form of excessive government control. This is not, by the way, a political message. I'm just drawing an illustration here. But think about this in relation to the kingdom of God. Romans chapter 14, verse 17, Paul says this: the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, meaning that the kingdom of God is not about taking care of the stuff in this world as it is with earthly governments. So the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Our great reward in the kingdom of God is that Jesus paid a debt he did not owe. We owed a debt we could not pay. We are forever indebted to Jesus for the privilege of being welcomed into God's eternal kingdom, for being made fit to live and serve in God's kingdom, holy and righteous and blameless in his sight. That's why we sing Amazing Grace. For Jesus paid a debt we could never pay, and we get to love him and serve him eternally in the kingdom of God, a kingdom of righteousness and of peace and of joy in the Holy Spirit. Secondly, I hope you got that first one, we're indebted forever. Secondly, our great reward, and that's a reward, the fact that we're indebted. Just want to make sure you get that. Our great reward is received, secondly, only in giving back praise to the king. Take a look at verse 2. All his acts of power and might, together with a full account of the greatness of Mordecai, whom the king had promoted, are they not written in the book of the annals of the kings of Media and Persia? Take a look at the greatness of Mordecai, for example. Esther and Mordecai were rewarded for their faithfulness. From Mordecai, that reward came in the form of a highly exalted position in the kingdom of Persia, in addition to the estate of Haman that had been awarded to him through Queen Esther. And for Esther, her royal position used to be just a title. She was kind of the king's plaything. But her royal position as queen now became so much more than a title. She had the full trust of the king, who entrusted her to carry out his will and his authority. But that great reward both Esther and Mordecai now enjoyed would always be an extension of and dependent upon the acts of power and might of the king. In effect, Esther and Mordecai were the personifications of the king's glory. They became the visible sunshine, while the king was the power of the sun that caused them to shine. In the same way, those today who remain faithful to Jesus will receive as their great reward a share. Listen to this. You will receive a share in the glory God has bestowed upon Jesus. Paul lays it out clearly in Romans 8, verses 17 and 18. He says, now, if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. To which he then adds, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. In us. What will that glory be like? Well, the scripture says in Hebrews 1, verse 3, the Son, S, capital S-O-N, Jesus, the Son, listen carefully, the Son is the radiance of God's glory. The Son is the exact representation of God's being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. You and I, as difficult to believe as it may seem, will share in Jesus' glory as the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of God's being. Holy smokes! 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 14, Paul says, he called you to this. He called you to this through our gospel. That's part of the good news. So that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. How many times have we read words like this and it's just gone right over our heads? In other words, our great reward in heaven includes being a visible, perfect representation of God's invisible being. This happens the very moment Jesus returns and we are caught up to meet him in the air. Peter puts it this way in 1 Peter 5, 4. And when the chief shepherd, that's Jesus, appears, you will receive the crown of glory that will never fade away. In fact, the process of our transformation has already begun. The moment you surrendered your life to Christ, you were born again in the Holy Spirit of God. He has taken up residence in your body as his temple. His presence in you is like a seed germinating in good soil, transforming your old sinful nature into a whole new level of humanity, modeled after the incorruptible nature of Jesus himself. That new nature reaches its perfection the day we see Jesus face to face. The New Testament puts it this way, 2 Corinthians 3:18, and we all, who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory, just think about it, are being transformed into his image. That's present tense. We're being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. It's happening in us right now. Jesus' resurrection is proof that we too will be raised imperishable, and that that resurrection body is also part of our great reward. And our resurrection will be the first installment of the transformation that God will eventually bring for the entire universe. His creation will once again be truly set free of the physical laws of entropy, decay, deterioration, and death that were imposed upon it by Adam and Eve and their sin in the Garden of Eden. And so Paul wrote in Romans 8:21, the creation itself, meaning all that exists, the creation itself will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the freedom and the glory of the children of God. And like Esther and Mordecai, our great reward is also one of exalted positions and authority in the kingdom of God. But that great reward is always, like theirs, an extension of and dependent upon the acts of power and might of the King. You, his faithful church, are the eternal sunshine, while God himself is the power of the sun that causes his church to shine. That's why the scripture says in 1 Corinthians 2, verses 7 and 8, we declare God's wisdom, a mystery that has been hidden, and that God destined for our glory before time began. Let that bit set in. God has given us his wisdom, which Paul describes as a mystery that's been hidden until the gospel was released. And then he says, none of the rulers of this age understood it. For if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Is not all this written in the book of the annals of the King? Why is it so important that these deeds of Esther's and Mordecai's and all that took place in ancient Persia, why is it important that it was written in the books of the annals of the King? Why does it matter? Well, there are those today who would like to describe Esther as a fictitious character in a drama written long after King Xerxes reigned. This verse tells us, along with other portions of Esther, but this verse tells us that everything recorded in the book of Esther was written down as a matter of verifiable history. Check it out in the books of the kings, is what he's saying. Beyond that, the book of Esther itself is now a permanent witness, a recorded testimony for all generations, for all time, of this barely escaped Jewish Holocaust in ancient Persia. Kings have always kept a record of their reign and their accomplishments with the intent that their name and their legacy be remembered. Esther and Mordecai, who now had the influence to affect what the king would record in the annals of the king for posterity, they wanted the story of their salvation to outlast themselves, to be told not only to their descendants at the celebration of Purim, but to be shared throughout the non-Jewish peoples as well, so that all who read the account will be moved to praise. It was Esther and Mordecai's great desire that their accomplishments reflected back on the acts and the power of the king. And like Esther and Mordecai, you and I who belong to God through Jesus Christ have been highly exalted. We have been granted, as our great reward, as Peter puts it in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, we've been granted an inheritance that can never perish, never spoil, never fade. This inheritance, he says, is kept in heaven for you. Throughout all eternity, your faithfulness to the Lord during this time in your mortal body, when all the forces of sin, the flesh, and the devil did everything in their power to tear you away from the love of God in Christ Jesus, your faithfulness will not be forgotten. David writes in Psalm 112, verse 6, surely the righteous will never be shaken. They will be remembered forever. And because this is true, whatever God has you doing, personally, whatever he has you doing throughout eternity, wherever he has you serve him throughout the vastness of the new heavens and the new earth, you will always, always, always be returning the honor that God's creatures give you as the first fruits of Jesus' resurrection, you, the sons and daughters of God, you will be returning that praise back to God, for he has always been your strength through Jesus Christ, and you will want all creation to know. So as all the acts of power and might of the king, together with a full account of the greatness of Mordecai, whom he had promoted, were written in the books of the annals of the kings in Media and Persia, so too will all the greatness of God be celebrated because of you. Because of you. Forever and ever, your great reward is to return those praises to the king. Psalm 111, verse 4, he has caused his wonders to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and compassionate. Third, our great reward is receiving second place, second to the king. Take a look at the first part of verse 3. Mordecai the Jew was second in rank to King Xerxes, preeminent among the Jews, and held in high esteem by his many fellow Jews. It's not often, that in this life anyways, that receiving second place is considered the highest honor possible. But that's another unexpected twist in the way God dishes out his great rewards. There is no greater place. There is no higher place. There is no place of more authority and influence in all creation than to be seated with Christ Jesus in the heavenly realms, who is second only to God himself. Paul says it this way, Romans 8:34, Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. That is our position in Christ. Now and throughout eternity, that is our great reward. Not granted, catch this, that reward is not granted to any other creature, not even the angels. The authority and the power you are entrusted with now in Jesus' name will be magnified beyond our current comprehension in the kingdom of God. You are in training now for that great reward in heaven. He expects us to be actively preparing now for that day when Jesus comes to take us to be with him. And yet, even as I say those words, many of you are saying to yourselves, I have no idea what heaven's going to be like. Well, God's word, heads up, is filled with descriptions of what the kingdom of God will be like. And we need to dive into his word, to prepare ourselves for it, to train for it now. That's why it says in Colossians 3:1, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Dig in, folks. Get into his word. And finally, our great reward is based on Jesus' recommendation to the king. The last part of verse 3, where it says, because he worked for the good of his people and spoke up for the welfare of all the Jews. We saw a moment ago in Romans 8:34 how Jesus is at the right hand of God, and he's also, interceding for us. Now, sometimes people misinterpret that to mean that Jesus is constantly kind of pleading on our behalf for God's mercy instead of the judgment we deserve. Like a lawyer who's seeking the leniency of the judge, even though you, the criminal, are undeniably guilty. But that's not what is meant here by Jesus always interceding for us. The truth is, the charges against us have been dropped. They've been dropped because Jesus accepted the punishment for them on the cross on our behalf. There is no angry God waiting to pass judgment on you once you have now accepted what Jesus has done for you. The doors to your cell have been flung open. You're free. Free to go. It's only those who can't accept God's gracious offer who remain in the cell, insisting on taking the punishment they deserve. Those are the ones who face an angry. No, when Scripture says Jesus is interceding for us at God's right hand, it simply means that, like Mordecai at King Xerxes' right hand, Jesus is tirelessly working for the good of his people interceding for the welfare of all his followers. It is Jesus who ensures the promise in Romans 8:28 that all things work together for those who and are called according to his. It is Jesus interceding for us at the Father's right hand who ensures the promise in 2 Peter 1:3 that his divine power, not ours, his divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through the knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Once upon a time, it's true, we were sinners in the hands of an angry God. Ephesians 2:13, however, says, but, I love the word but now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Colossians 1:22, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy. That's what Jesus does. He presents you to God. You're holy. Now I got to stop here. Because you read it, you hear it, up here you believe it, but I'm not sure you do down here. So get this. Jesus has reconciled you. You are reconciled to God. Can you say amen to that? He did it by presenting his physical body, and he did it to present you holy. Can you believe that? Really? Can you say, I'm holy?
I'm holy.
Can you say that? I am holy.
I am holy.
Because Jesus did it. You didn't do that. It means he set you apart. And he put his Holy Spirit, his Holy Spirit in you to make you holy. You got to get used to saying this stuff because it's true. He has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight. Get a load of this. Without blemish. Yeah, I'm going to do it. Go ahead and say, I am without blemish. That's hard, isn't it? I am without blemish. Because you're without blemish in Jesus Christ who died for all those nasty blemishes you got all over you. I am free from accusation according to 1 Peter, 2 Peter, wherever we are. Colossians 1:22. It's in the Bible. He has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. I am free from accusation. Don't you love that song we do here sometimes? I am free. You know, I am free from accusation. You got to own that. It's not what you did, it's what he did. 1 Peter 2:10. This really is 1 Peter. Once. That may have been yesterday, 2 weeks ago, or 20 years ago, but once, you are not a people. But now, you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. God doesn't take that away. He gave it to you. You have received mercy. For you were once, says in 1 Peter 2:25, you were like sheep going astray. But now, you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. All this and more is part of our great reward. And we have received this great reward based on Jesus' recommendation to the king. It's the only thing that gets it on our behalf. Because Jesus is continually interceding for us at the right hand of God. Esther and Mordecai. Real people living in dangerous times. were spared by God's grace. They and the entire Jewish population in Persia, that population was the nation of Judah transported as slaves and as prisoners by the Babylonians, who then lost the kingdom to the Medes and Persians, and the Jews are still there in the land, dislocated from their own homeland. These are the people who were almost made extinct under Haman's vile plot. But as a result of Esther and Mordecai's trust in God, as a result of their courageous determination to do what was right, even at the cost of their own comfort, the cost of their own relationships, even their own lives, they were greatly rewarded for their faith. What then shall we say to this? We who have far greater advantage as people who are born again and indwelt by the regenerating, sanctifying presence of God's own Holy Spirit. What should be our response to this? Well, perhaps this great song of the faith from the late 1800s says it best. You might even want to say it there, right where you sit. It's up to you. All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him. And in his presence daily live, I surrender all. Let's pray. Lord, you have preserved for us such a great cloud of witnesses. Those who have gone before us, who have lived before us, and some who died before us in horrific ways, and some, like Esther and Mordecai, who were greatly rewarded even in this life for their faith, but either way, such a great cloud of witnesses who walked in faith with you, trusted you, and were ready to die, give it all up, lose everything for you. A people surrendered to you. We would be such a people. We have already said, most of us in this room, many of those listening online, have said, I give my life to Jesus. And in doing that, we surrender. Your Lord, your King, not us. Many more out there, perhaps, have not. I'm sure that's the case. Today, this can be the day that changes. You choose sides between the Hamans of this world and Jesus Christ. All it takes is I surrender all. All to Jesus, I surrender. I surrender all. In his name we pray. Amen.
Please stand with us.
The path of soul, but you reign.
the God who gives endurance and encouragement, give you a spirit of unity among yourselves as you follow Christ Jesus, so that with one heart and mouth, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And God's people said, Amen. Amen.